أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. وإن كنتم في ريب مما نزلنا على عبدنا فأتوا بسورة من مثله وادعوا شهداءكم من دون الله إن كنتم صادقين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. والحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. وإن كنتم في ريب مما نزلنا على عبدنا. This is the ayah we almost finished discussing last night. And if in fact you, all of you, or any of you are in any doubt whatsoever in regards to what we have sent down upon our slave, فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ, then bring a surah, مِن مِثْلِهِ, that is anything like it. وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, this is the part we didn't discuss yesterday. And call on your witnesses, the witnesses all of you have, any besides Allah. A couple of things in this portion of the ayah. The first of them is, there is mahara, expertise. Allah did not say bring your experts, He said bring your witnesses. This changes the, it expands the meaning of the text. One of the things it does is it includes those false gods that they worshipped, and they were calling on them as witnesses to the truth. So Allah is basically making a mockery. These things are your truth, why don't you bring them as witness? So it's a kind of mockery of their false beliefs. The other thing that happens here is for them, the ultimate, the witness of truth was the highest form of speech. In other words, the poet, the eloquent speaker, these were the leaders of the society because of their expert knowledge of the language. So you have people that can testify to whether something is, you know, the word of insanity or it's the highest form of eloquence. You have those experts, and the, a term for experts used in ancient Arabic is witnesses, because they testify to whether or not something is legit or not. So they're doing the testimony, they're the certifiers. So Allah says, why don't you bring forward your the highest form of your testifiers? And they tried this already. For instance, Walid ibn Mughira, and the Quran dedicates a passage even to his, you know, experience with the Qur'an and how he has to come up with an explanation. This isn't poetry. I know poetry, this ain't it. Okay, this is absolutely not insanity. If we call it insanity or the word of a madman, then we're going to negate our own selves. It's going to invalidate our own claims. So what can we come up with? Well, how about this one? Let's just call it magic. It causes separation between father and son. In other words, let's create hysteria about this Qur'an so that people avoid listening to it because they're afraid of magic, like they would be afraid of a sickness or an epidemic or something like that. So anyway, Allah says, وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Bring forward your witnesses, in fact you are, as opposed to Allah, other than Allah, any other than Allah, if in fact you're truthful. And here again, something very subtle in the Arabic of the Qur'an that doesn't come out in the English translation. The word غَيْرَ in Arabic means other than. So if you say, وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ غَيْرَ اللَّهِ, bring your witnesses other than Allah. That meaning is the same. But dun, dawwana in Arabic is to be inferior. So here when Allah says other than Allah, He's actually kind of pointing to the fact that whoever you call is going to be inferior to Allah anyway. How are you going to bring a witness that's going to compete with the word of Allah? وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. Allah is enough Himself as a witness. Then He says, فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا. If in fact you haven't been able to do so thus far. Lam refers to the past. So if you hadn't been able to do so, acknowledging that this entire span of the life of the Messenger والسلام, unsuccessful attempts have been made, nothing has been brought forward that can compete with this Qur'an. وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا. And then, so first there's a commentary about what's gone on so far, and now he says, and you won't be able to do so. So he not only comments on their failure in the past, but openly challenges them, guarantees them, you won't be able to do so. وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا. فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. Then protect yourselves, be cautious of, be fearful of the fire. This is also very beautiful and subtle. The Qur'an began, this surah began with people of taqwa. But taqwa of who? Of Allah. But it's clearly been demonstrated that these people at the point of no return have no fear of Allah. So now they can't be invited to the fear of Allah anymore. What are they invited to? If you can't fear Allah, then you know what? Why don't you go and try to protect yourselves from the fire? Here also there is sarcasm. In other words, how are you going to protect yourself? Go ahead, make all the precautions you can. It's coming after you. This surah also has a lot of sarcasm against kuffar. Already we learned Allah yastahzi'u bihim. Allah is the one making fun of them. Here we're learning fattaqu an-nar. How are they going to have taqwa from the fire when they're trying to produce a competitor to the Qur'an? They're guaranteeing themselves hell. So this is a means of sarcasm. Later on in this surah, we'll find other places. For example, بِئْسَ مَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِ إِيمَانُكُمْ The Israelites will be told, what a horrible thing your iman tells you to do. Your faith? This is what you call faith? What terrible things your faith tells you to do. You know, Allah didn't say your kufr tells you to do bad things. He's being sarcastic with them. Later on, he says about the hypocrites and the munafiqu and the Israelites together, he says, فَمَا أَصْبَرَهُمْ عَلَى النَّارِ What amazing patience they have to withstand the flames. You know, this is sarcasm of Allah manifest in this surah. And this is appropriate because the people we're dealing with were the worst in their insults and their criticisms against Allah's book. Anyhow, وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ So why don't you protect yourself from flames, the fuel of which is people and stones. Allah mentions this fire is flamed by the fuel of it, instead of being wood or oil or things like that, it is fueled by people and stones. Now people, of course, those who deserve hellfire. Stones, some ulama commented, this is also found in tafsir of some sahaba, they used to worship idols made of stone. So you will burn along with your idols. You will burn with these stones that you worship along with you. So وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ Also others commented that a fire made of stone, meaning lava and melted stone, there's no comparison between that flame and that intensity and the flame of anything else. There's no real comparison. So Allah alludes to the intensity of this flame. Then He says, أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ This has been prepared for الْكَافِرِينَ Those who are bent upon disbelief. Those who are deniers. I didn't get to mention this before, but the word kafir in Arabic comes from kafara, to bury a seed inside the ground. Kuffar in Arabic, which we know as disbelievers, that's actually in the Qur'an, in Surah Al-Fath, it's also used in the meaning of farmers. The same word kuffar. Why? Because what does a farmer do? He plants the seed in the ground. The idea of calling a disbeliever kafir is that he already had the truth inside him before he even came to this earth. The seed of truth was already there. He buried it inside and never let it see the light of day. The light of Allah came and wanted to come in contact with the light that was inside him, which Allah describes as nurun ala nur. There's a light inside you, there's a light from revelation, light upon light, that phrase you may have heard before, right? But this light inside of him, he buries it. Because he buries it, it's never able to meet that light, so this is called kafir. So, أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ If you want to look at a literary explanation, it has been prepared for those who buried the truth inside and kept it there. These are the disbelievers. Then he turns to the opposite, and he says, وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Now, here, Allah Azza wa Jal could have said, وَأُبَشِّرُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْ التَّبْشِيرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Meaning, congratulations to those who believe. But actually, he commanded his messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, told him, you congratulate those who believe. You congratulate those who believe. So now, you have to understand this remarkable thing that's happening here in between the lines. The challenge was against the Qur'an, wasn't it? Produce a surah like the Qur'an. But how is the Qur'an coming to them? The Qur'an is not coming to them by email. Or by any kind of broadcast. How are they coming into contact with the Qur'an? Not even on paper. They're coming into contact with the Qur'an by means of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So a denial of the Qur'an, at the same time necessarily is a denial of the Messenger. The two things are one and the same. As far as denial is concerned, they're one and the same. So now on the one hand they've denied the Qur'an, but at the same time that means they have done kufr against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now that same Messenger is being told, you from this same book that they're denying, congratulate those who believe. وَبَشِّرْ You congratulate those who believe. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ And have acted righteously. This condition has been added. You see, if you say, وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Congratulate those who believe. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا includes three kinds of people. Now this is not commonly understood. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا includes people who really have faith inside. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا also includes people who have weak iman. They have weak faith. But even then when Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا They're included in it. Actually, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا also includes hypocrites. It even includes hypocrites. Why? Because even they claim to believe. So when Allah says, those of you who claim to believe, those of you who have professed iman, then it includes all three groups. But the congratulations is not to all three groups. So to make it more clear and restricted, Allah says, وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ No, congratulate those who've professed their belief,
they've entered Iman and they act righteously, thus confirming their belief. So it's a more restricted group than just saying الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And if this is confusing you a little bit, I'll tell you briefly. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, for example, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَا لَكُمْ. Those of you who believe, what's wrong with you? Now if يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا only refers to true believers, well, there's nothing wrong with true believers. When Allah says, إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ انْفِرُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ اثَّاقَلْتُمْ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ. When you're told, march forward in Allah's path, your feet get planted into the earth. This is the attitude of the hypocrite. But the ayah didn't begin, O those of you that are hypocrites. It began, O those of you who believe. Similarly, very clear-cut case in Surah As-Saff. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Those of you who claim to believe, why do you say what you don't do? Well, who does that? Whose attitude is of saying something and doing something else? That's the hypocrite. But even when they were addressed, what phrase is used? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So it includes all three, but then when Allah restricts it to the true believers, then He adds a condition, which is وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. That especially and only for them, there are gardens at the foots of which rivers are flowing. You've heard this many times. Gardens underneath which rivers flow. If you're reading English translations often, you've heard this phrase over and over again, Allah describing paradise in this way. But we don't stop to think about it. We don't stop to think about it. Understand something. Even in this modern day, after thousands of years have passed, century after century has passed, even to this day, the highest real estate is waterfront properties. And it's at an elevation. If your property is at a low elevation, then it's susceptible to flooding and all kinds of other problems. But if your property is at a high elevation, then if there are any problems, then you know they trickle down and your property is still safe. And the higher it is, the better view it is. Real estate agents will go and take you straight to the window. Check out the view. You know, check out the balcony. They'll take you there. And you'll find the higher the floors are in high-rise buildings, the more they charge you. And even in hotels, if your hotel like window is facing the ocean property, the ocean side, then they charge you more. This idea of human beings being able to view water from their homes, right? This is even precious to human beings today, even today. So Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us things that are innate inside of us. What I'm trying to get at is, when Allah talks about jannat, gardens, even gardens, you know, I used to live in on the East Coast, and when I first I got married, we used to live in New Jersey for a little while, South Jersey. This is right by the Atlantic Ocean. And all these millionaires live there, right? So there are apartment complexes, and all of a sudden there are these, at least, each property is at least 2 acres. And these are waterfront properties. And the front yard is about an acre, right? Lined with trees, high walls. You can't even see inside the house until you get to the gate, which is kind of a grill, so you can see through. So when you're driving, you get a little peek inside the mansion and you go, whoa, that's nice. You know, the trees covered the entire driveway, goes all the way inside, and behind it you could see the ocean. This idea of beautifying gardens, this idea of having a nice lawn, you know, greenery, shrubbery, these are things that are innate inside human beings. You know, even in people that live in places like the concrete jungle in New York City, you know what they'll do? They'll get the apartment on the 10th floor, but their windows covered with greenery. And they'll put like flowers and things like that, and hang plants and palm trees. Why? Because they want that imagery. And if they can't have that, at least they'll put a picture of some greenery in their house. So this is innate inside human beings. Allah gives us what we want. Look, you and I'll probably end with this ayah today, you and I are going to struggle even if you're not a believer. Even if someone's not a Muslim. You ask them at the end of the day, any hard-working human being, what do you want to work towards? What do you want to get? You ask a man living in America, you ask a man or woman living in China, you ask a man or woman living in Indonesia, anywhere else. What do you want to do with your life? What's the final end game? You know what most people will tell you? At least I want to buy a house. At least I want a house. That's what I want to work up towards. And maybe when you're younger, you don't think like that. When you start getting older, you think about the acquisition of your own land, property. This idea of wanting something permanent that's not going to go away is inside us. And if you're living in a house that's for rent, every day you think, how much have I saved now so I can put down for a house? How can I make this situation permanent? Because you feel like you're unstable. You're not really settled if you're living on rent and you don't have something to your name or it's not paid for, etc. This is inside of us. Allah put this inside of us, and one of the wisdoms of that is so you'll really learn to long for paradise, because He's giving you real estate that's permanent. And He's giving it to you custom made just for you. You know, it's one thing to buy a foreclosed home and a home that's like, it's the price is right but nothing else is, you know. It's, that's one thing to do that. But there's another, to buy a house or to get a house, to acquire a house that is exactly